This is Surface Maps via Adaptive Triangulations, as presented at Eurographics 2023. I am Patrick Schmidt, and this is joint work with Dörte Pieper and Leif Kobbelt at RWTH Aachen University. In this work, we present a new way to compute bijective maps between surfaces and to optimize them for low distortion. What distinguishes this work from previous ones is that we now have control over the resolution at which a map is represented, independently of the input mesh complexity. This allows us to compute maps much faster and more robustly in a coarse-to-fine manner. We will be mapping via the sphere, and this currently limits the method to genus zero surfaces. However, we are able to map between entire shape collections at the same time, which is something that not all previous methods are able to do. In a lot of different scenarios, we need maps that bring the surfaces of 3D objects into correspondence. For example, to transfer information, such as textures, weights, or other surface data. Or if we want to interpolate between models, we need a map that tells us which point on one surface to blend towards which point on the other surface. And more generally, whenever we want to process multiple surfaces in correspondence, we usually need to construct some form of common base domain between them, such as this compatible triangulation here. But again, that requires computing an underlying surface map. A particularly high-quality class of maps that we're interested in are surface homeomorphisms. Between a pair of triangle meshes, these are maps that are defined at every surface point, so not only at the vertices, but also everywhere on edges and inside triangles. These maps are bijective, so they are free of foldovers, and bijectivity also implies that they are invertible, so we don't have to worry about the mapping direction. And finally, homeomorphisms are continuous in both directions, so when moving a point around on one surface, its image on the other surface follows continuously, without any jumps. And while strictly staying within the space of homeomorphisms, we want to optimize maps for low isometric distortion, so we want to minimize the total amount of stretching and shrinking in the map. And a nice consequence of this type of isometric distortion optimization is that it, at least locally, aligns similar geometric features, like the wing we can see here. However, a majority of existing works fulfill either one or the other of these two goals. So there are methods that compute strict homeomorphisms, but they usually don't directly optimize end-to-end mapping distortion. For example, they might optimize distortion into some intermediate domain, or they might compute conformal maps which have no angle distortion, but can have very high scale distortion. On the other hand, there are methods that do optimize some form of distortion measure, but they usually relax the notion of homeomorphisms. For example, by only mapping at the vertices, or mapping not exactly to the target surface but to the ambient space around it, or by, more generally, mapping between distributions of functions instead of points. Usually, this means losing continuity and bijectivity guarantees. There are only very few methods that actually combine both aspects, optimizing strict homeomorphisms for low distortion. This is quite a challenging problem setting, and these approaches that include our previous works, they can produce very high-quality maps, and some of them even work for arbitrary genus instead of just genus zero. However, they tend to result in quite complex algorithms that are not so trivial to implement, full of robustness challenges, and often slow at runtime, yeah, sometimes up to hours for a pair of moderately sized input meshes. A key source of this complexity is the use of common tessellations that exactly represent both surfaces, for example in the form of overlay meshes. These are required for a piecewise linear description of the map, and they serve as a discrete integration domain for distortion measures. Overlay meshes contain the vertices of both input meshes, as well as all of their edge-edge intersection points, so this is quite a complexity blow-up. It's also difficult to achieve full numerical robustness because overlay meshes inherently contain near-degenerate elements, and they also require the intersection of almost parallel edges, which is an ill-conditioned problem. There is one recent method that at least gets rid of the explicit edge-edge intersections by using common intrinsic triangulations instead of overlay meshes. This is a very attractive setting, but there is currently no guaranteed way to compatibly construct these triangulations on two meshes. In any case, the complexity of all of these representations is always tied to the number of input mesh vertices. Now, our approach is to use common triangulations that only approximate the input surfaces instead of representing them exactly. In addition, we also maintain a bijection to the original surfaces, and that allows us to still produce strict homeomorphisms. Compared to overlay-based methods, this now improves robustness because we have full control over element quality. It increases performance because we can now work on coarser resolutions, and it also arguably leads to slightly simpler algorithms. On the downside, we now have to worry about surface approximation quality, which is an issue that did not exist when using overlay meshes. So we are making a trade-off here, but we find this trade-off to be very worthwhile. We can now compute low-resolution homeomorphisms between the original high-resolution input meshes within seconds rather than minutes or hours. And this makes interactive workflows a lot more practical. A related problem setting is compatible remeshing, where these triangulations themselves, instead of the homeomorphism they imply, are considered the output. However, most methods here follow a two-step process, where they first have to solve the entire surface mapping problem with all its challenges, and only then generate a common triangulation. And in this work, we will combine these two steps in a single optimization. So here's our map representation for a pair of genus 0 triangle meshes A and B. We will later extend this to more than two surfaces. First, we independently compute two maps to the sphere. Both of these are bijective and they will remain fixed from now on. Most previous methods would now directly compose them to a map between A and B, but instead we will bring them into correspondence via a third triangulation T. This is an abstract triangle mesh that has geometric embeddings on both spheres. And now this defines a piecewise map between them. And now we can compose these three maps to a homeomorphism between A and B. Now, because all three maps are bijective, their composition is bijective as well, and the whole construction is symmetric. Now, we could visualize this homeomorphism by lifting the common triangulation to the input surfaces, but its triangles would now show up as curved patches on these input surfaces. Actually, computing these patches would require overlay meshes again, and that's exactly what we wanted to avoid. So our approximation is to only lift the vertices of the common triangulation and to connect them via flat triangles in 3D. And this is what forms our approximating common triangulations called TA and TB. Yeah, their vertices lie exactly on the input surfaces, but their triangles do not. Now, besides the homeomorphism between the original meshes, there's also another map between these approximating meshes. And this map is much simpler. It's trivially defined because TA and TB share the same connectivity, and most importantly, it is piecewise linear. And when optimizing mapping distortion, we can now discretize our distortion measure on this approximating map, which serves as a proxy for the actual homeomorphism. We will formulate this in a single energy minimization problem, but we will exploit two different types of degrees of freedom. First, our continuous variables are the vertex positions of mesh T on both spheres. Yeah, if we move vertices on the sphere, their 3D images will follow accordingly. And we will move vertices on both spheres at the same time. Now, the second degree of freedom that we want to exploit is the connectivity of mesh T. And we will adaptively coarsen or refine this based on the same objective function. Our optimization algorithm looks pretty much like a remeshing algorithm. In each iteration, we first perform a series of edge splits, then edge collapses, and then edge flips. But now for each candidate operation, we locally evaluate the objective function before and after, and only apply the updates that strictly decrease the objective. And after that, instead of a smoothing step, we apply a second-order Newton update of vertex positions on the spheres with respect to the same objective. This objective function is a sum of multiple terms, and let's go through them one by one. First, to keep our representation valid, we need to make sure that the triangulation remains embedded bijectively on both spheres. So for this, each of these spherical triangles needs to have positive orientation, and we can characterize this by instead looking at the tetrahedron spanned by the origin and the three vertices, and making sure that this tetrahedron has positive volume. And we add a barrier term that maintains this property. Next, we want to measure mapping distortion between the two approximating triangulations. So for each triangle, we first lift its vertices from the spheres to the surfaces, and then measure the symmetric Dirichlet energy between the two instances. However, this formulation is totally flexible, and we could use any other type of distortion measure instead. It doesn't even have to be flip preventing, because bijectivity is already guaranteed by our barrier term. Now, besides the two instances of this triangle being similar to each other, we also want to individually control triangle quality. And to do this, we choose an ideal shape and size for each triangle, and then again measure the symmetric Dirichlet energy between the ideal target triangle and the actual triangle on the surface. We always choose an equilateral shape, and we pick the size adaptively from a sizing field that we defined on the input surface. Now, one effect that happens is that when the optimization algorithm moves a triangle over the surface along some path, then the target size of this triangle changes continuously along this path, depending on the underlying field. And when we later differentiate our objective, we will make sure to take all of these effects into account. By default, we compute our sizing fields based on the local curvature, so that we get finer resolutions in regions of high curvature. But the overall scale of these fields is a parameter, and we use this parameter to drive our coarse-to-fine optimization schedule. Alternatively, we can also take user-defined sizing fields as input. As you can see here, we wish to produce finer resolutions around the face. And here we can observe how the algorithm that we just saw already automatically performs all the remeshing operations that are necessary to achieve this sizing. Unfortunately, controlling triangle quality alone is not enough to achieve good surface approximation, as since only the vertices are constrained to the input surface, but the interior of triangles is not, it can happen that geometric features like these fingers poke through triangles, and then there's nothing that prevents the mesh from retracting away from these features. And to mitigate this, we measure the surface approximation error as the distance from the input mesh vertices to their corresponding points on the approximating triangulation. And we add this as a penalty term to our objective. And here we can see how this immediately fixes the issue. In some of our experiments, we also replaced this penalty by a barrier, and that allows us to maintain hard approximation bounds. In terms of complexity, this is the only term in our objective that depends on the number of input mesh vertices. So this is a dependency that we wanted to avoid. So in practice, we just choose a fixed size subset of vertices at which we measure this error, and this is usually enough. Now, our final objective function is a weighted sum of these terms, and in the paper we show that a reasonable set of default weights can be found that works well in different scenarios. Again, this formulation is quite flexible, so besides the bijectivity barrier, which is the only mandatory term here, everything else can be freely replaced by alternatives, or we could add new terms to the mix. Because we perform Newton-style optimization of vertex positions, we will need the first and second order derivatives of this objective function. And we compute these via automatic differentiation using TinyAD. This is a small C++ library that we presented last year, and it's really the tool that makes such algorithms possible and relatively pain-free to implement. Because the full objective function is quite complex and manually differentiating it would be a huge task. Let's look at one optimization sequence in detail. So here we start with the input meshes and optionally with a few landmark correspondences, and we can initialize the common triangulation with any triangulation of the sphere. Here we just choose a copy of mesh A. But this means that the landmark constraints are initially not fulfilled. So in a first algorithm phase, we switch to an extremely low resolution at which we can quickly satisfy these landmark constraints via an additional penalty term. And note that guaranteeing landmark satisfaction in general is a very hard problem, and this is just a heuristic approach to it, but it works well enough for a reasonable choice of landmark positions. Now, despite the low resolution, we already obtained a very smooth map between the original input surfaces. But some geometric features, like the wing we can see here, might not be well aligned yet. So in the second phase, we then perform the main map optimization, still at a relatively coarse resolution. And here we can see how this already properly aligns this wing. And finally, in the third phase, we then refine to a target resolution, which gives enough degrees of freedom for fine-level map adjustments. Here's the whole sequence again. And this took a total of 40 seconds to compute. 20 seconds were spent to pre-compute the initial maps to the sphere, then less than 1 second for landmark satisfaction, only 2 seconds for the coarse map optimization, and finally 17 seconds for map refinement. In comparison to other methods that optimize strict homeomorphisms, we achieve almost the same map quality, but in much shorter time. And so this example here takes minutes or hours using 2 previous methods, but only 45 seconds with our method. If we look very closely, we can see that some of the inevitable distortion is distributed a little less smoothly with our method, and this is due to the coarse resolution that we used. So this is an artifact that goes away with further refinement in case that is required by an application. As already mentioned, we can also map between more than two surfaces at the same time, and really not much changes here. So again, each surface has its own map to the sphere, and we have a single triangulation T that now has geometric embeddings on all of these spheres. And we can run the same algorithm that optimizes these embeddings simultaneously. In our objective function, most terms are defined for each surface individually anyways, so these stay exactly as they are. Only the distortion measure is defined between pairs of surfaces, and to prevent a quadratic number of terms, we only choose a subset of pairs for distortion measurement, for example in a circle or in a star pattern, depending on the application. Our common triangulation now defines homeomorphisms between all surface pairs, no matter which ones we picked for distortion measurement. And these maps are cycle consistent by construction. This means that I can start with a point on one surface and then follow any sequence of maps. And when I get back to the surface where I started, I will also arrive back at the exact same point. This is a very nice property to have, and it's because any point on any surface is now uniquely defined via its barycentric coordinates in a triangle of mesh T. And finally, here's an example of texture transfer from the first surface to all others. It took 73 seconds to pre-compute these sphere embeddings, so this step does depend on the input mesh complexity, but then only 23 seconds to run our optimization. We already used this algorithm to speed up an application in developmental biology. In a previous work, we were given this dataset with 51 snapshots of the early mouse heart at different points in time and from different specimens. And the task was then to create a time-continuous model of the average growth process by interpolating within this dataset. Now this here is the resulting animation, and with our previous mapping algorithm that was based on overlay meshes, this required computing 50 pairwise maps, and that took a total of 36 hours of computation time. Now with our method, we can obtain almost the same result, but we reduced the total runtime to just 38 minutes. In conclusion, we presented an algorithm that makes the optimization of bijective maps between surfaces faster, more reliable, and hopefully a bit more accessible. We also combined the disciplines of surface map optimization and compatible remeshing in a single formulation. Since we only covered the genus 0 case, the obvious next step would be to generalize the method to higher genus, for example via tilings of the plane or the hyperbolic plane. This comes with a few practical challenges, such as a robust handling of cuts and transition functions, but also with more theoretical challenges, such as the choice of map homotopy classes. Finally, since the objective function in our method is quite flexible and can be replaced by alternatives, we're excited to see different variations being explored in the future. And for this, we've made our code available on GitHub. So if you're interested, check out the code or have a look at the paper, and feel free to reach out to us in case you have any questions. Thank you for your attention.